I browse BookTube and great, I watched some great videos and I saw, I read the worst book ever, the worst book in the world. And yeah, those books were pretty bad. I watched a few entries like some handbook for magic thing or whatever, and it didn't leave a good impression with me, but there are much worse books out there. I heard of an author some while back, an old-timey author around the 19th century, and she wrote that bad that there were contests among other authors like Lewis C. Carroll and Tolkien, who could read the longest without bursting in laughter. I mean, that's really bad, yeah? And it hasn't aged well. Fortunately, you can read it for free on Project Gutenberg, so I will read a few sentences out of the book for you. I tried this out before starting my camera, and it's a real challenge reading this out loud. Not to burst in laughter is one point. The other point is English is my second language, and it's really complicated for me to pronounce all these adjectives and adverbs and flowery purple prose, so I think that will be a great test and a great exercise for my English. I hope you enjoy the following passages. All right, we are here at Project Gutenberg, and this is the book Irene Iderslide by Mrs. Amanda McKittrick Ross. Belfast, 1897. So, yeah, like I said, it's an old-timey book. Chapter 1. Sympathize with me, indeed. Ah, no. Cast your sympathy on the chill waves of troubled waters. Fling it on the oasis of futurity. Dash it against the rock of gossip. Or, better still, allow it to remain within the false and faithless bosom of buried scorn. Such were a few remarks of Irene as she paced the beach of limited freedom, alone and unprotected. Sympathy can wound the breast of trodden patience. It hath no rival to ensure the feelings we possess, save that of sorrow. The gloomy mansion stands firmly within the ivy-covered, stoutly built walls of Dunfern, vast in proportion and magnificent in display. It has built over 300 years, and its structure stands respectably distant from modern advancement, and in some degrees it could boast of architectural designs rarely, if ever, attempted since its construction. The entrance of this beautiful home of Sir Hugh Dunfern, the present owner, is planned on most antique principles. Nothing save an enormous iron gate meets the gaze of the visitor, who at first is inclined to think that all public rumors relative to its magnificence are only the utterances of the boastful and idle. Not until within its winding path of finest pebble, studded here and there with huge stones of unpolished granite, could the mind for a moment conceive or entertain the faintest idea of its quaint grandeur.
Beautiful, however, as done from mention may seem to the anxious eye of the beholder, yet it is not altogether free from mystery. While many of its rooms, with its walls of crystal, are gorgeously and profusely furnished, others are locked incessantly against the foot of the cautious intruder, having in them only a few traditional relics of no material consequence whatever, or even interest to any outside of the ancestral line of its occupants. Oh dear, this sentence didn't age well. Within the venerable walls surrounding this erection of amazement and wonder may be seen species of trees rarely, if ever, met with. Yeah. Oh, erection of amazement. That's too good. So, I'm at chapter 2 and the MC made her first appearance. But there awaited his view another beam of life's bright rays, who, on entering, last of all, commanded the minute attention of everyone present. This was the beautiful Irene Eidslight. How the look of jealousy, combined with sarcasm, substituted those of love and bashfulness. How the titter of tainted mockery rang throughout the entire apartment, and could hardly fail to catch the ear of her whose queenly appearance occasioned it. These looks and taunts, serving to convince Sir John of nature's fragile cloak, which covers too often the image of indignation and false show, seals within the breasts of honor and equality resolutions of an iron mold. On being introduced to Irene, Sir John concluded instantly, without instituting further inquiry, that this must be the original of the portrait so warmly admired by him. There she stood, an image of perfection and divine beauty, attired in a robe of richest snowy tint, relieved here and there by a few tiny sprigs of the most dainty maidenhair fan, without any ornaments whatever, save a diamond necklet of famous sparkling lustre and priceless value. Okay. I think I read worse descriptions of the MC. At least there was no mentioning her eye color, her multicolored eyes that shone like whatever. The beginning of chapter 3, I mean, what's this? Arouse the seeming deadly creature to standard of joy and gladness which should mark his noble path. Endow him with the dewdrops of affection, cast from him the pangs of the dull past, and stamp them forever beneath the waves of troubled waters. Brighten his life as thou wouldst that of a faded flower, and when the hottest ray of that heavenly orb shall shoot its cheerful charge against the window panes of Dunfern Mansion, the worthy owner can receive it with true and profound thankfulness. What is this? What is the seeming deadly creature? Arouse the seeming deadly creature. The seeming deadly creature. Standard is maybe, she means such a thing, a flag is on, not like that there's a kind of behavioral standard of joy and gladness. So some deadly creature should rise to some flag of joy and gladness, and the creature has a noble path. I think penis the whole time, but I'm sure that's me and not her. the seeming deadly creature. I mean, a penis is not deadly creature, but it's arouse and creature and seeming deadly, because it's not deadly, but if you're a slight woman, you can say, does this fit? And then standard, it's standard, like those military standards, they are kind of penis-like as well, should mark its noble path. And then endow is another penis word. And when the hottest ray of that heavenly orb shall shoot its cheerful charge, hey girls, she's speaking about you know what, right? Until now he was inclined to be prejudiced against the snares and allurements of women, but he strongly resolved to try gradually and abandon every unkind thought harbored in his mind against them, fearing lest all his conjured imaginations were both unjust and selfish, and determined to drown them forever in the clashing gulf of fate, felt of prouder and happier mortal than before. Felt a prouder and happier mortal than before. I mean, that's pretty progressive, right? He was prejudiced against women, but he said, yeah, I'm on a new page and I will try to lay my prejudice at rest. Good for him. But time would solve the problem and heal the wound which penetrated so deeply his bosom. Yeah, a short time, he hoped, would bring his creeping fever of endearment under the binding stay of appointed authority and heal its weakening effects with the sacred wealth of truth. As he no longer fettered with fear of fighting. Oh, that's great. Fettered with fear of fighting. With his inward friend, obstinacy, whose hand of drowsy bachelorism seemed forever close to his changing charity, he had at last thrown aside the garb of female dislike and patronized that of a warm-hearted lover. Oh, that refers to garb. So he patronized the garb of a warm-hearted lover. I would love to know how a garb of a warm-hearted lover looks like. Yeah, the chapter beginnings are the best. When, on the eve of glory, whilst brooding over the prospects of a bright and happy future, while meditating upon the risky rite of justice, there we remain, wanderers on the cloudy surface of mental woe, disappointment and danger, inhabitants of the grim sphere of anticipated imagery, partakers of the poisonous tracks of concocted injustice. Yet, such is life. Ah, we have our first dialogue. Can it be possible? Exclaimed Sir John in profound astonishment. Why, I have been searching for you for some time past, and I have accidentally found you at last. Irene, rising to her feet in a second, was utterly dazed, and had the dim lights shewed her proud face to advantage, the ruddy glow of deepest crimson guilt would have manifested itself to much greater degree. Making multitudinous apologies, etc., she at once joined Sir John, who led her back in apparent triumph to share the next waltz. How the true heart beat with growing passion during the remainder of the merry festivity, and as the final announcement of separation was whispered from ear to ear, the gradual wane of love's lofty ride would fain have dwindled into pompous nothing, as the thought kept tickling his warm enthusiasm with the nimble fingers of jealousy. That she, whom he had ardently hoped, should share his future with sheer and loving caresses of constant companionship and wife-like wisdom, should be trapped in probably vowing to another her greatest devotion for him. What? But better allow the sickening thought to die on the eve of insult rather than live in the breast of him who, at no distant date, would hear the merry peals of wedding bells ring with gladness and naturally rejoice at the object of their origin. Oh, all right. I think I have enough. So you think you know a worse book than this? Write me in the comments, yeah? But you really have to be convincing. I mean, we are at chapter 3 or 4. This is a agglomeration of awfulness, incomprehensible awfulness. I read to you one other part. It's the first sentence of another of her works, and it's one of my favorite books, beginnings. So we're at TVTropes.org, creator Amanda McKittrick-Ross. Have you ever visited that portion of Aaron's plot that offers its sympathetic soil for the minute survey and scrutinous examination of those in political power, whose decision has wisely been the means before now converting the stern and prejudiced and reaching the hand of slight ed to share its strengths in augmenting its agricultural richness? Opening lines of Delina Delaney. I first read this sentence nearly 3 years ago. Since then, I have read it once a week in an increasingly desperate search for meaning, but I still don't understand it. Nick Page, in search of the world's worst writers, on the above sentence. Yeah, I mean, I let this stand for itself. So, dear book lovers, dear lovers of horrible literature, I challenge you to read a book of Amanda McKittrick-Ross. First, that you appreciate the current standards of literature more, and second, that we all have something to laugh. Bye-bye.